Flint Charter Review Commission, Committee of the Whole, is called to order. If there's anyone who would like to conduct an invocation, you may do so at this time. Roll call.
Mr. Cherry?
Here.
Ms. McGee?
Here.
Ms. McKenzie?
Here.
Mr. Metcalf?
Oh, he's here.
He's here.
There.
Mr. Richardson?
Present.
Ms. Wesley?
Here.
Mr. Williams?
Here.
Okay, you've got Nancy Murphy and Heidi Fanoff not here.
Review and approval of the minutes for August 25th. If you take a moment to review.
I'll report to the group that I'm drafting.
Okay.
And I didn't have it done at this point. And if anybody would like to give me some assistance as I work on this ethics thing and this idea of the of an ombudsman commission, I'd appreciate any kind of help. Anybody wants to read over what I'm writing and argue with me about it.
Jim, we chatted a little bit before the meeting on that, and one of the things I'm going to try and get Jim a little bit of an outline, hopefully not to hinder him, but to help him. But one of the things I think would be important, if we could get some feedback as to what you individually think, and it'll be duplicative of what are the important things that the elected and the appointed officials should do and should not do. In other words, thou shalt not use city funds for personal or political purposes given. And you should, attend council meetings or attend your office or so on. So are there some things that you might just send them to Jim so that we have a paragraph to cover all of those transgressions or those things that should be compulsory. He has a bunch from Detroit, we have some from the old charter, but there might be some things that are missing.
Things like follow the charter.
Yeah.
Well, I'll be happy to help with that, but like I said, I think everybody should have a
sure
input on those things, but I'd be happy to read.
Is that something we should talk about now, or? Or,
sure. Mm-hmm. Or I don't know.
If we have moments in the meeting.
Right.
We could.
Yeah, why don't we?
Oh, sure.
Well, one of the pieces that we're so concerned about is assuring that folks follow the charter. Well, I think we've said those comments around this table on several occasions by almost, I think, all members.
Mm-hmm.
That if we've got this document, this law, so to speak. I believe it is a law, isn't it?
It is very much a law.
Then it's expected that if you get then a sworn into office or appointed to a position, then one of the things you've got to do is follow the charter.
The charter basically is our constitution, federal constitution. Then all the laws have to abide by that, state constitution. The charter is our city's constitution, and the ordinances and all the activities have to be not constitutionable, but charterable, or whatever, if there's such a word. And that would be the second thing that we would be working working on is what would be the mechanism. But right now, the first go-around would be what are the compulsory or prohibited acts.
What is there going to be a certain section that we craft, that we're working on, a section we're going to add that says these are the duties, responsibilities, and required?
Yeah, I'm working on it. It's kind of like those standards.
Yeah, this is all elected officials.
Yeah, involved. And appointed.
Mm-hmm. And appointed.
Okay. Sort of like what constitutes ethical behavior in government, where you're spending the taxpayers' money, mm-hmm. and are responsible for the expenditure of the taxpayers' money.
Where you're representing the city, and you're representing the whole citizenry.
Yeah.
Would it add any credence to another, instead of saying Flint City Charter, Flint City Constitution?
You're changing the vocabulary of the state law. The Home Rule Cities Act speaks of city. Each city shall have a city charter.
Okay. You can add it on the other end. Add it on the other end.
Oh, city charter. Constitution.
Right. Then you want, then it doesn't interfere with saying it's
well,
the charter.
I'm just wondering if charter doesn't seem to be a strong enough word for the people who are most aware of it. And maybe along with some of the punishments for breaking the Constitution.
So is your main concern that the elected and appointed leaders don't care about the charter? Is that what you're trying to get at?
I don't think so. And maybe that's because all these years there hasn't been anybody busted because they've done something against the charter. So if you're getting away with it, everybody's getting away with it, or doing and saying what you want to do. And,
once again, you're right, because the community doesn't know anything about it.
Right.
Then the elected and others know of it, but not use it.
So I wonder if having a certain level of training on, I guess, the basics of municipal government might be of use to both elected and appointed officials.
Along with the statement of ethics.
But it could be ethics. When you're getting trained, you can tell them what you want them trained on. But you're right. If I take this office, then I have to go to the municipal training program to take the position. And then you can't say, I don't know anything about my position as it reflects to the charter.
Including appointees.
Including appointees. Mm-hmm. Whoever it may be, if the city hires them, and their appointees or elected officials, I think they need to go to the municipal league of cities. And they need to class on, especially the department that they're going to work in. If it's the police department, DPW, whatever it may be, there's rules about for every department that was in there. And then ethics is part of that. And then when we close this book, and the back of that book should be, say, what is some of the consequences of not following.
The only problem I have with that is most department heads, other than the attorney and probably the administrator, they only look at their particular role in the charter of, this is my department, this is what we're supposed to do. But so much of the other parts of the charter impacts their departments as well, and then they don't realize what some of the other areas are in the charter. You know, and then there's problems that come
right,
because, right. Yeah, because they're not paying attention to some of the other areas, such as the ethics and conflict of interest and those kinds of things.
Well, I don't know how long is a session or class that you think it would take, something like that. Is that a week or two?
I think that would be something that the league would have to kind of decide, looking at the charter.
I've done a lot of training sessions for the Michigan Municipal League, and I have taught in the newly elected officials academy, where they have, and there are two main components that I think would be applicable. A 3-hour component that deals with the structure of government, and you would want to have it focused on the Flint structure of government rather than a general, because you want to drill down into the Flint City Charter. And then another 3-hour component that talks about the roles and responsibilities of the elected officials. And then it goes on to talk about finance and land use or so on. But those first three, the first 6-hour components are the critical ones. And I've done similar things for other municipalities. Everybody knows where beautiful downtown Empire, Michigan is.
Empire, Michigan? That's the city?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, is that like Benzie County or something like that?
It's up there. It's actually, it's just by Glen Lake. So you can do Bear Dunes Park up in that area. I don't know what county it could be, Benzie. But anyway, that would be, it would be at least...
It's crossroads.
Population of 14.
Yeah.
But they all have the same problem. They don't read, they don't... listen, and sometimes by spoon feeding them in a training session, we usually bribe them with a meal or something like that, and do a training session.
Well, attorney, how many hours do you think would be necessary for anybody, for any elected or appointed person need? How many hours?
Six contact hours. So spread it out 1 hour a night for 6 days, or one Saturday for 6 hours?
That doesn't sound like enough hours to me. That's why I asked that.
You don't even... I don't think so. The difficulty, of course, is to get the people to come, too.
And well, they can't. What I was thinking when you were talking, they can't take the job until they finish
right.
The court.
Okay.
That's what I'm thinking.
That'll.
If you got a 12-hour course, you can... take it any way you want to. You apply for the job, the guy said, hey, you got the job, but here's the stipulation. You have to go to this 12-hour program.
What about the elected official?
All of them.
Oh, they're sworn in, aren't they? And they may be sworn in before that takes place. They can't swear them in. How would that work?
But if it's written, if it's part of the charter.
This will have to take place prior to swearing in.
Swearing in. So, the individual knows he's going to get the job, but there's this one little catch in there, a 12-hour program.
For the appointed, yeah, I've got it.
Or elected.
Well, I don't think you can do it before they're going. I think you have to do it
after.
Yeah, because the next month, we could change it potentially, but it's like the Monday after whenever.
After the election.
There's one. Oh,
yeah.
Okay, for the elected person, right.
Yeah.
That's city council people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And mayor.
My council person told me that one weekend all the council people had to go to a training just last year, and it was a weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And it was after they were elected.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, the emergency manager made the council, all the council go,
mm-hmm.
and their pay was dependent upon it,
mm-hmm.
because he had slashed their pay,
mm-hmm.
and they weren't going to get it back until they all completed it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You could maybe do that and say they have to get sworn in and they have to start, but they don't get paid until they
finish
the training.
Okay.
That may be.
Where do
mm-hmm.
they send them?
Mm-hmm.
To the Michigan Municipal League?
Yeah.
The elected officials?
That's where they either come here for the entire group or they go to Lansing for some program.
They went to Lansing. I know she went to Lansing.
Yeah.
Well,
okay.
When you were a councilman, I heard
somebody.
Well, but
I heard somebody saying that they have special training for the council people just on Robert's Rules of Order. Is that true?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, they would do that. Almost everybody, because you had to learn how to speak your term, especially when you're in finance.
Well, I mean, there's precedence right there for having this. If they have to know that, then they should know the.
Well, most people who run into some political thing have some ideas of Robert's Rules of Order. So it's not a real hardship thing to learn and grasp for me.
You know, an hour, a couple hours, yeah. Just so that you learn your motions, what motions you make, when you can speak, when your turn, a little bit on agendas, a little bit on minutes, a couple hours of that would be good.
Well, I'm just looking at the precedence that sets. If they have to do a vote to that, then why shouldn't they have to go to a meeting of the charter?
But I don't know if that Robert Drew's order was a have to. You see what I mean?
Yeah, but what he's saying, if they had to go because of to learn Robert Drew's order, then surely
they should be able to do the rest.
Right.
In the, I noted with interest that in the section in the on the in the Detroit's ethical standards, they have a section in it that says that all elected officials have to attend a training program on the ethical standards.
Well, I think that makes sense, so you can't plead ignorance on what is ethically required of you.
Right. Mm-hmm. So it's built in that. It's interesting, it's built into that piece.
Yeah, but you just said on ethics, what about the rest of it?
I don't know about the rest of it.
Oh, okay. You know,
I'm just saying that's what that section is. So I just finished reading it, you know, so I'm remembering that. I noticed, John, that when we did proposal number 13 around conflict of interest, one of the thou shalt nots is self-dealing.
Mm-hmm.
And in any way, for yourself or your family at all. And that's basically what you're getting at for the conflict of interest, isn't it?
Right, yeah.
Is not self-deal.
Mm-hmm. And this applies to more than just elected and appointed, so, but yes.
Right. But that's one of those items.
Yeah.
You know, another one that's pretty common is that you don't use your the resources of the municipality for political purposes.
Yeah. That's a big one.
That is, you know, that's any of the resources.
Even staff.
Yeah, well, particularly
especially staff.
Especially staff, yeah.
Particularly staff.
At that time of year, we usually have to be very careful of how much paper we leave in the copier so that they don't come in at night and print a bunch of election flyers.
Really?
Mm-hmm. We've had them do it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, technically, that's larceny in building, and larceny in building is a felony.
Do I could be? Actually, how much paperwork you use?
That's been grounds for termination.
Larceny in building doesn't matter what the amount is.
Connection in building.
In building, yeah. So if you larceny out in the street, it's got to be over $100, or it's got to be a regular or something like
that. So another one has to do with employees not doing election work while on the clock. You know, that's a thou shalt not. How do we get at the whole idea that the reason you're doing this work is in order to serve the public, the needs of the public? How do you put that into a positive?
But they say that all the time. Yeah. I mean, they always say, you know, it's the public I'm working for, it's, you know. I mean, they say it all the time. They always say, you know.
I like to act naive.
I will I think probably both honest and corrupt politicians believe they are acting in the public interest.
Or at least they're going to save it. No one else will save it.
I think psychologically people justify things to themselves that from the outside don't seem justifiable.
If you buy a bunch of ice cream for some kids and you use political public money to do so, but it's really politically set, I'm doing this for the kids. I'm doing this for the people in the neighborhood. But really, you can't use the public's money to do that. But then they have they used to have a stipend that you had. They could do it with that little bit.
They had a what?
Stipend.
Well, it was a...
What do you call it?
Just a little fund that each council person used to have.
Each council person had a little fund.
Where did they get the... Who funds the fund?
The city gave them like $200.
And they could spend any kind of way they want in their ward.
So a little bit of stealing is okay, but a big lot of stealing is not okay.
That's right. But you just told us that you have to make it so it's for Michigan, and this is for Flint, Michigan. That's been going on for.
They didn't use it for campaigning. They used it for things like their Christmas parties and stuff. Mm-hmm. But I don't believe they have that anymore. They don't have the money.
You know, Treasury has a list of things prohibited. You know, illegal expenditures, and that's buying donuts and coffee for the staff at City Hall.
Right.
Can't use that for. You know, that's an illegal expenditure. Things like sending flowers to the mother of the deceased mother of a council member, you can't use funds for that. If you have that sort of slush fund, you better, you know.
She said they don't have it anymore, so.
Yeah, you have the right to remain silent. And he's, okay. Anyway, you know, it's funny that the federal government, they have the Hatch Act, I'm sure everybody knows about that. The senators literally go across the street to a private office buildings to make their telephone calls to solicit money. They don't do
that. That's what happens in Lansing, too.
I was shocked.
That's what happens in Lansing, too.
Yeah, so we have that culture of separation of the public office, you know, from the... Why don't we...
Have it here.
I was shocked at the amount of time they spend doing that.
Yeah.
I mean, they spend most of their time soliciting money, and that's just seems strange.
Because they're not using public telephone. Right. Yeah. Right. But so who pays for the bill across the street? The individual.
Their campaign funder. That's their
the
campaign.
Party.
Yeah.
Okay. So I've been in that office.
Which one?
The one that the senators go across to make those political calls.
Yeah.
The person who owns that building, or did own that building, was Stuart Mott.
In Washington?
In Washington. Huh. It's set right between the Supreme Court building and the Senate office building.
Hmm.
And and there's a walkway that goes from this building. And Stuart owned this thing.
Is this a son?
Yeah.
Son Stuart.
Yeah.
Stuart Rawlings.
Stuart Rawlings, who's now deceased.
Mm-hmm.
You know. But I was in it for an event one time. You know? He was a big supporter of Planned Parenthood, and we had an event in there while we were in D.C. at one time. And, you know? That's how I got to know about it. I arranged for him to do it.
Anything else?
So I have using of resources for political or personal purposes. We have a conflict of interest and self-dealing. We have nepotism.
Oh, nepotism.
Excuse me.
I've worked for the DPW in Flint, so I know all about that rule doesn't exist.
DPW Water Department.
Just cross that out.
Well, you have to remember, Flint grew up on it, really. You know, if your brother, uncle worked in a certain department and you want to get in that department, it would just naturally.
Yeah, well, that
General
was true in a shop,
General Motors is run
too.
Like that.
Huh?
General Motors is run like that, yeah. Especially in skilled trade. If your father
skilled
was a skilled tradesman, all he had to do was have his son or daughter put an application, they'll pull it, and they got the job the next
and
same day.
Somebody else sponsored them.
That's right. And they got the job the same day.
But it doesn't mean we can't put it in there.
General Motors and the city of Flint is a different entity.
Right.
You know, that's General Motors stockholders' money versus taxpayers' money. Am I sounding too draconian here?
That's what you pay for.
Yeah.
Tell us. Don't let us.
Just that I know that it happened here in Flint when Buick was here and AC was here and those other places.
There was no attempt to hide it. I worked for a guy. He didn't live in Flint. In fact, most of the workers didn't live in Flint. But he had 6 sons and 3 daughters. The 3 daughters worked over here as secretaries and stuff like that. All of his sons were foremen. It was a family affair. I mean, I can tell you a number of families. And I had an aunt working here, and that's how I got a summer job here for 4 years going through college.
Helen? Oh, Helen. But you're not related to Helen.
Helen Wilson?
Yeah.
No.
Well, see, and the difficulty with nepotism is how do you supervise your family? How do you discipline a family member? How do you, you know, it's just so fraught with all sorts of problems. And
that's right.
We had a city manager, and it was in the Flint Journal, that his family was making $1.2 million in salaries from Flint, Michigan.
When was this?
A long time ago.
When Brown was the city manager.
Oh, I don't know.
Mike Brown?
Yes.
Yep.
You don't know this? I don't remember. It was a Daniel Baldwin.
Well, I mean, we could sit here and go through all kinds of stuff, you know.
Well, I think we probably should have something on that.
Political communism.
What is that?
That's when you hire someone who has given substantial amounts to your political campaign and they have no qualifications to serve in a particular office.
Well, what's going on today? Well, really? I didn't say that.
How do you prove that? I'll say that.
Yeah, that's what I'm curious about. How do you prove that?
His name was Scarlett.
But now I think we're nicked.
Well, you have a campaign list, don't you?
We're going through all this.
When someone does receive donations, you have to submit your list of where you receive your monies from, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if that person gets hired in a job and you want to know did they make a financial donation to somebody, all you got to do is pull the campaign list. If their name is on there, if they're employed, that's your proof.
Well, that's
public document.
Except it's not proof that they aren't qualified for the job.
Well, I mean, that's where, let's say you're mayor and I gave you $5,000 towards your campaign and you put me in a position, say city administrator. And somebody wanted to know, did I get the job because I made financial statements, financial contributions to you? And someone pulled the public records, my name is on there, $5,000. Goes to the ombudsman, hey, I want you to check into this, make sure this person is qualified. Here's the proof, I already did the legwork for you. They made a $5,000 campaign contribution to the mayor. Is this legal?
Yes, but the question is he qualified?
That's what I just said. The ombudsman can check it out and find out if I'm qualified.
You can just look at the record. The person, you can look at the personnel record.
No.
You don't have to go that far. If a citizen pulls it out.
But is the personnel records public record?
the personnel other than police and fire are public records.
Okay. So, I mean, that's, there you can go with your proof that way. So if we put it in the document, it can be found out very easily.
Ethics is there for there to be transparency, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what we're getting at here.
Mm-hmm.
Transparency of the ability to do the job, qualifications for the job. Not that you're trying to hide anything.
Right.
His name is Chair, my name is Chair.
Mm-hmm.
I put that together.
Right.
So ethics is there to provide for transparency, but according to the lawyer over there, it also puts you on a hanger for when we got nepotism going on.
Mm-hmm.
It's there to be some litigation that
mm-hmm.
you can avoid if you did not participate in
mm-hmm.
that type
mm-hmm.
of employment practice.
And that's where
so
the
that's
training.
So it's hard to
yeah.
rein in.
Yeah, and the training. You know, if I'm in training and I'm told I can't do that,
right?
Or these are the consequences, and it's written in the charter, then I might think twice, do I really want to risk my job and the job of a family member or an acquaintance mm-hmm. by doing this, or am I going to leave it alone?
There's another one I'd like to throw out, and this is a sensitive one, would be dereliction of duty.
Yeah.
You know, we have certain responsibilities of police and fire, and that they have to take action. And we have other departments, code enforcement, code enforcement officer who does not write the tickets when he does see the violation, does not prosecute the tickets, turns us back, doesn't necessarily get bribed, but just does not, or does, do you do window inspections here, or windshield inspections? You've heard that term when you have a building inspector drives past the building and says, well, that looks good, fine, we'll pass it, those kind of inspections. A dereliction of duty, and I hesitate, but I guess it needs to be said, did we have that in the water department by somebody somewhere in terms of appointed officials in the whole water scheme, not just the department, but those people who touched that, was their dereliction of duty. And here it says, thou shalt pay attention to your job, thou shalt do it with a level of competence. Those are kind of things, I guess, what I'm trying to help Jim with, to get his juices stimulated, to get you going on those.
But if you list every single one of them, you'd be doing 10, 15 pages of thou shalt not.
Well, we know that
thou shalt. Dereliction of duty, when you say dereliction of duty, you know what your duties are. Did you do it or not?
Yeah, but I'm saying, when you look at all the things that we don't want people to do, or that we're going to make it an offense to do it, I mean, we'd have 10, 15 pages.
I mean, do you have to have a lot of faith? I mean, dereliction of duty, to me, all you'd have to do is look at, they've got the list themselves because they have their job descriptions. So that's what you have to go by. We wouldn't have to write a whole slew of things in the charter.
That's what I'm thinking. Job description tells
right,
you
it tells
job.
You what, exactly what you're supposed to do.
And a lot of things that we've talked about today that are against the law, against the city charters and stuff like that, they're done.
Yeah, that would be, that's an easy one. Thou shalt obey the laws of the land. No violation of the law.
Mm-hmm.
Charter, ordinance, state laws, whatever, you obey the law. Affirmative statement. It's a violation of your duty to violate the law, whether that's driving drunk or whatever.
It's awful broad, huh?
Well,
no, it's clear, but we only need one line in the charter to say that we're going to do that.
I would say violate the law in relation to your duties, right? But I mean, if I get cited by
right.
you know, a blight control officer because my lawn was too long? Are we going to say that's a...
Because...
Or you get a red light ticket.
It happens in our neighborhood.
Right.
But
cut your grass.
Yeah, you get a ticket for not cutting your grass.
Okay, I'm lost now. I don't understand how that...
Blight control. If
you're in an area of the city,
right,
and you run a red light, and you get pulled over and get a ticket, is that the... you've broken the law. Does that mean it puts your job in jeopardy?
If you are driving during work time, or
anytime.
Yeah.
That's what they were talking about. Anytime.
Sunday morning, going to church, on your own time.
I mean, I think it should be interrelated to your
job.
Yeah.
There's a provision. Is anybody in the military on our side? Any chance? No.
Military?
Yeah, in the military.
Our army?
On our side?
On my side?
Yes, he was on our side.
I was getting shot at, but I wasn't on another guy's
side. You haven't went to ISIS yet?
There is an uniform code of military justice, UCMJ. You remember that?
Yeah.
And it says conduct unbecoming
an officer.
And that is defined in two or that's applicable to listed also, is that if you bring the army or the military branch into disrepute, and if you impede the efficiency of the operation.
Right.
So is the red light ticket going to church, does that bring the department into disrepute?
No.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And how would they find out anyway?
You got a ticket.
But now you're a police officer in uniform driving drunk. Does that bring the department in disrepute? Or,
mm-hmm.
you know, as a matter of fact, going through a red light by a police officer, other than with lights and siren on, going to an emergency is a violation of law. Not going to lunch, it's not an emergency.
Or a donut shop.
Yeah. But so there is a definition of what brings the department into disrepute, and then the other one would be the efficiency of the department. You know, if it doesn't fit into some of the other categories, that's sort of a catch-all type of a thing. For example, sexual harassment. If you don't deal with that specifically in the specific code sections, that would bring the department, or lessens the efficiency of the operation, you know, because the other people can't function as well as they should. Also,
the sheriff.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. As the sheriff.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
And I see what you think, because as when I was on, my lieutenant got in a car accident while he was still on duty, but he's a lieutenant, so he's out of uniform. So his buddies, who other police officers, rushed him to, took him from that thing, rushed him to, what is it?
Urgent care or something?
No, a place where people put alcohol.
Rehab.
They put him in rehab before anything. And so when they tried to prosecute him on that, saying he is sick. That's what they use.
And he's on his way to rehab.
And he's in rehab.
Okay,
he's not on his way.
Yeah,
he's in rehab.
Snatched him.
Right. They took him from the accident.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Because he was on his way then.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. If I tell y'all who that is, y'all flip your lids.
I don't need to
know. No, you don't need to know. You don't need to know.
I think Jim and I are sort of looking for what are like these, what are the do's and don'ts that, that what's bothering you? Is there something that you have come across that you specifically want to call out that should be incorporated?
I think one of the things that we heard in some of our community meetings, especially since we're going to be looking at them monthly, is that people are not in the office during office hours. That really seems to be something that curls the hair of the general public. They expect people to be in their office during office hours. Now, if they're at a meeting, that's one thing, but all the time, from what we were hearing at some of these meetings, people are not in their offices, so they don't have anyone to go to.
I think that was just bad management, office management, mm-hmm. because you have two investigators, they're going to be out investigating. Mm-hmm. Then where is the ombudsman himself? Then the secretary is there. So mm-hmm. I don't know. When you got to remember, when you go to these meetings, people are upset about stuff, mm-hmm. and they kind of over-dramatize their situation. But you need to have somebody to attend mm-hmm. an office at all times. Mm-hmm.
So the secretary would be there all the time.
The secretary should be there at all times.
The item that really got to me was the attorney refusing to sign things as to form. Would that be counted? Would that be fit under dereliction of duty?
He did it because he felt he was.
It's a she. Don't let him in on this one.
This person thought they were right. That's not a stretch.
Because we were told that person has not signed any since they've been here.
Right. So. Haven't signed any?
No. Right. So that's...
Why aren't they not signing?
That's what we're saying.
Okay. I'm out. I can't answer.
As part of their duty?
Mm-hmm.
As,
yeah.
So what was
because
the,
they need their signature. Because there's a person that's on council right now that went and did that and act like an attorney.
Yeah, I heard
okay?
about that.
And he should have went to the city attorney. The city attorney would have to sign off on that. Or give the council an attorney and let them sign off on it. And that wasn't done. So by him refusing, the way we're talking, that'd be derelict of duty.
It would be.
Yeah. Am I right on that?
Okay. You know, assuming facts generally that are
yeah.
on the table, I don't
that
know
we don't know.
Evaluate the conduct.
For what we said on the table.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if a lot of these do's and don'ts, if we just put, derelict of duty in the charter, when the training takes place, a lot of these innuendos that we're speaking of can be given as examples during the trainings. And then that way we won't have to list every little thing, because you can't. But that could be part of the training, that supposing this happened, this is what we are supposed to do in this particular situation.
So they should be able to grasp it.
Right.
So if I didn't grasp it at the training, and I'm now sitting in my position as councilperson or whatever, and I need clarification, who provides that for me?
Would it be the city attorney?
The city attorney, all legal, as councilperson or anybody. As elected officials.
Assuming the city attorney knows what their job is and what they, you know, if they know what their charter is and, you know, have some experience, you know, dealing with municipalities.
That's how we wound up
going
all over the city to get elected.
Yeah.
Exactly. And maybe that city attorney need to be at the training too.
Of course.
Mm-hmm. I'm having a bit of a problem with the notion of creating a list of do's and don'ts. My problem with it is if there is something missing from the list.
Mm-hmm. So,
isn't included within the list, then that provides, and clearly it's unethical or, you know, some
But it provides a loophole.
Can we speak about this?
Yeah, I'm dying to I think the way you do it is you say, these are the minimum things that you cannot do, but other things may be added to the list by the board or you know whatever the
who adds it though. You can't say that to the charter.
The ethics board.
The ethics board that we're talking about.
Or board of standards, whichever.
The term is including, but
not limited to.
You put some language in there. Have you folks looked at Josephson's standards for ethics for government officials?
Who?
Josephson.
I don't know.
Mike Josephson.
Never heard of him.
He was professor at Wayne State and is out in some very expensive neighborhood in California, and he has the Josephson Institute for Government Ethics. And he's boiled it down to about 5 or 6 bullet points.
Say it again, Josephson's.
Josephson.
Spell that.
Spell that, yeah.
Josephson.
Josephson.
Michael Josephson. And, you know, I can pull it out and I'll get you the links or whatever. And he has spoken to the Michigan Municipal League in years past and is quite persuasive as to, and he, in the 5 or 6 standards that he has, encompasses in a general, broad sense.
Yeah, I want to look at that.
As to what is expected of public officials.
Yeah.
So that might be a resource that you look at.
If you can remember, please send that link.
If I can remember, why do you think I have my book and my red pencil?
I don't know. Maybe you're just drawing stuff.
I think another thing that the public is at a disadvantage, even if we craft this language, they are unaware of it, that they can bring forth issues that should be investigated or something. And I guess when we get to talking about the ombudsman and all of that, we need to make it plain to the public that these ethics issues are not just for the elected officials and to toss around. It's actually, the public should keep the council in place and all other people in place that represent them and their tax dollars. So, you know, somehow the public has to know that these things exist.
Madam Chair, in fear of monopolizing the meeting, I share an experience I did at Vassar, the city on the street there. As they did it, we did a series of training sessions for the city. And the mayor just finally said, why are we doing it just for the city council?
Mm-hmm.
So we went to the high school and we had the folks sitting on the stage. I was doing my lecture and I had 75, 100 citizens mm-hmm. listening in as to what the council was learning so that those folks in the audience could hold the council members responsible or accountable to know what they were learning.
Yeah.
And they were willing to do that. Just to take
just to keep it in mind.
That would be great because we have the people who attend council meetings and probably some right now upstairs who their opinions of their role is quite contrary to, you know, in my opinion, to what a citizen, you know, their performance and so forth.
No, and I guess now we're looking at, instead of going to Lansing for training, having the training here so that the public can come.
If that's possible.
Mm-hmm. Now, do we not, some communities have I know they have a police academy and they teach citizens police school.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe a concept of a citizens government or just general government school might be for those who are interested.
When we have an election, and let's say the only thing on the ballot is the charter, how many voters do we have in Flint?
How many voters with the ballot
voters? How many registered voters do we have in Flint?
Mr. Mayor, how many left registered voters do you think? Since you've been in the lab. as compared to the first one. Well, I know they used to say 100,000, but in reality, I would think probably about...
Well, we only have 100,000 people now.
100,000 registered voters, they said at one time. So I would probably think in reality, you got easy 50,000, 60,000,
50,000. 50,000 to 60,000.
That's a lot.
So then out of that 50 that's registered, how many come out and vote?
How many are going to come out to the
charter only election?
Yeah.
7%.
But there may be other items on the ballot.
If it's...
Well, I guess the point I'm getting to is that, you know, we're spending some time on redoing this, and I have to confess that before I signed up to be on this commission, I had not seen it, I had not read it. So how many people are going to be that interested in common citizens? Interested good people who aren't going to go to the polls because they don't know what the heck this is about. People still think I'm on the
City Council.
But that's one of the things that have to happen is the, you've got to get the word out.
The education of the community, too.
And that's what we, and that's why we've been having community meetings all along.
Yeah.
So at least
yeah,
we'll get those votes.
Right.
How many people do come to those community outreach meetings?
15, 25?
No,
not
the community meetings.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Not the community,
no, community meetings. The community meetings, oh, okay.
50 to 75, yeah.
Don't y'all hold me to them numbers.
Sure.
Yeah, I think
it's
pretty high with our population at this point. That's a lot of those are children.
Because even when this whole thing came about was because of a city manager wanted to put this on the ballot. If he didn't put it on the ballot, it would never have came up.
Emergency
manager.
And so I think I got enough material to work with, and I keep working it, and I get to Charles and Cleor, and I get your feedback on it. But sure to argue with me about it, okay?
Oh, we will.
Might even be good too when you're finished with it to let's just sit down and the three of us hash it over.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm getting at.
Yeah.
But I may send it to you beforehand.
Okay.
You know,
just look at it.
Yeah, what I'm thinking, and if you think I'm, you know, way the hell off, all right, tell me, Richardson, you're way the hell off. You know.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's move on then. Marcia, do you have anything today?
Not today, Matthew.
Still working.
Anyone else on proposal?
I do have one I can bring up, but maybe some of the stuff that the attorney drafted for us before.
Well, one of the things I definitely wanted to, because you wanted to give us the presentation on the voting.
Sure. It's
ranked
choice voting. Yeah.
Yeah. It's ranked choice voting or instant runoff. You have a choice of that. And the first question I have to ask Mr. Cherry is, can we do this legally?
Ranked choice voting?
Yeah.
I assume that we can. I don't know. That's the question I have to you.
If we take a look at the... did that. An extra one of the handouts?
Yeah.
Here you go.
Oh, I have one. Oh, what's that? Is that something different? Oh,
this one.
Is the choice vote? What are you saying?
Okay, first of all, it's a different way of tabulating the votes. And I'll run through it. And the answer to the question is... The one that John asked me about, is it legal to do choice voting? And the answer, it appears to be yes. Because if we take a look at, and you may want to read this in the Home Rule Cities Act 117.3, parent A, close parent, talks about preferential voting. That's the definition. And this indeed is a form of preferential voting. I was talking to the AG's office about that, and they said they went through this at the city of Ferndale just recently, and they approved the charter. I don't know whether it passed or not in Ferndale, but at least it passed the test with the Attorney General's office. So the question is preferential voting. If you, and the best way, I don't know how to approach this in an understandable way, but I tried to do it by an example, and the example is perhaps the easiest way of understanding it. Basically what it does, it ranks the voting, or you rank the votes, the ballots that you cast. And if you will take a look at my example, I have voter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and they rank the candidate, candidate A, B, C, or so on in order. And this is totally in random order. And if you, and what happens is...
So if I'm voter 2, I said, candidate A is my first choice, candidate B is my second choice, candidate C is my third choice.
Correct. And so what you tally, the first tally to see if you have a majority of any voter or any candidate that has a majority. And as you can see, if tally one or the first tally, no one has a majority.
Because there's nine voters total, and A only got four, which is not above 50%.
And this is again where we have the instant runoff. We want to eliminate that second election, which is one of the benefits of this. We only conduct one election, and we have instantaneous results. So the first tally, A gets four votes, B has three votes, and C has two votes, unless I've screwed it up here in my example, which I might have. Okay, so what we do is we eliminate C, because he's the lowest vote getter, and then we take his choices, his first choices.
So voter 8 and voter 9 both rank C as their first choice.
Right. So the second choice that they vote 8 and 9 has, one has B and one has C.
B and A.
So our second tally, having eliminated C, A gets 5, B gets 4, and 5 would be elected because that individual has the majority of the votes. But just hold that thought for a minute. In the event I didn't get a majority of votes, we have to go to a third one or fourth one or so on. What you would then do is you would eliminate B, because B is now the lowest vote getter. Mm-hmm. And you take a look at where the B's would go, and he would go, the one vote would go up to A to give. And that's the way this system works. I'm oversimplifying, but that's the, and then you ask me what is the advantage of that, of the rank voting. One, of course, is money, because you save some money on that. Mm-hmm. The other, it discourages negative campaigning, because what you want to do is have the, if you can't win, you want to, you have the candidate who is most like you to succeed, so you don't trash the candidates as we have now. You know, I mean, even in the primary, the presidential primaries, we just trashed them all over the place. You would not have that if all of Rubio's votes would go then to, you know, somebody else. He would say that, you know, that is. And it enhances really the support of the majority, because the majority candidate has, even if he was not the first choice, he is a choice. He might be the second choice or third choice. He's not just an anathema or a enemy or so on. He is in the rank of that.
Okay, before you go any further.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Now, in the first tally, it was 3 and 2, and so you took the 2 and the C vote, and you gave it each. You gave it to each of A and B.
Yeah. If you take a look at voters 8 and 9, those are the 2 C votes.
Okay. So why wouldn't you take? Why wouldn't? Why wouldn't the total 4 go to A in the last column? Because you gave, you took 2, you took the total of C and gave it to A and B. So why wouldn't you take the total?
We just add on. You know, we eliminate C as a winner, and we take his second choice, and we attribute it to the candidates.
So voter A selected C as their first choice. Since C was eliminated, they go to their second choice, which is A.
Okay, why did one of the numbers go to B? Why did it just go to A in the
voter
first?
Voter 9. Because voter 9 chose C as their first choice.
And B was
okay.
And since C was eliminated, they go to their second choice, which is B.
Okay.
All right. Got it now.
We're not even going to talk about what problems this might cause for the clerk's office or so on. I don't even want to go there today, because there are some other communities, you know, that have done this and with some success. And there is a place in Massachusetts that is promoting. I think I made reference to that in my footnote in the back. That explains it further. But what I'm saying, this is the system, essentially, right. Oversimplified. Mm-hmm. And the benefits, like I said, is it saves some money.
We couldn't explain it to most of them.
Well, see, the question is, you know, to answer John, he asked me to take a look at this and to try and get the hands around it. There are some tremendous advantages. They use it in the European system. They use it for in Europe, they use it for legislature. There are a handful of municipalities in America that uses it. And as a matter of fact, the instructions that I have on page 2 and 3, this would be the sort of the language that you would adapt in your charter provision to explain the voting. And I just lifted that from the Illinois Senate bill that is a matter that's pending in the Illinois Senate that gives the option to municipalities if they want to pursue this type of thing. I think we have the option already if we are eager or interested in pursuing. And John, I guess I would, I can talk a little bit more about the advantages of that, but does this seem like a viable program? Is this what you were looking for?
In terms of information?
In terms of information, in terms of, do you want me to do some more work on this?
I'd just like to talk about it first.
Okay.
So, the reason I wanted the attorney to look at this is because one of the items that we've heard about from citizens and from other people who've talked to us is the issue of elected officials constantly being at odds with each other.
Yeah.
And with this, I think the benefit is it leads to less strife and negative politics, insofar as if, say, Commissioner McKenzie, Richardson, Metcalf, and myself are all running for the same seat, I'm not going to spend my time bashing them, because if I'm bashing them, their voters are unlikely to rank me anywhere in their...
Other than zero.
Other than zero, right? And so there's an incentive for me not to talk about how good I am as opposed to how horrible my opponents are. So I think it potentially could help in some of the issues that we've heard about. Now, obviously, the downside is it's difficult to explain.
For the first time around.
Yeah, I think it's once you start doing it, it's easy to do. It's you go in and you just rank who you give your preference in rank order of who you want to be in office. It's a pretty easy way to vote. It's just difficult to explain the tally.
Because actually the tally is basically the responsibility of the clerks, and not the person who's voting. They don't have to worry about how it's going to be tallied.
And that's the benefit of this system is that the general citizen only has to know the front part of this as to, instead of just marking an X on your candidate, you have to do 1, 2, and 3.
They would have to get all new machines, wouldn't they?
Oh, reprogramming the machines.
Oh,
okay.
Because what you would do is you would have a circle for first choice and block that out, and a circle for second choice and, you know, fill that in and so on. It's the reader would have to be adjusted, but you wouldn't need new machines for that.
Okay.
New ballots that would have to be printed a little bit different. And we do that for every election, the ballots changes.
I am really concerned about the electorate supporting this approach and change, you know, when it goes before them for as part of the charter. I can understand the advantages of it. I'm personally intrigued by it. The whole idea that I could rank all of the candidates who are running, and my third choice may turn out to be the one who gets elected, but I did rank them at one point. That's an advantage, but how do people feel about the electorate not understanding something and voting no because they don't understand it?
That's my concern. The no, because I just don't understand it, so I don't want to change. They're asking me to change to something that's foggy, and that's my concern.
Would it be possible for you to get some of the information that was presented to the public in those areas where they did change over? They must have presented something
First. Well, there are little videotapes on the internet that, and as a matter of fact, there's a radio broadcast on PBS that talks about that. We can play that for you.
John, what are the communities that have gone to this right voting?
So Minneapolis and St. Paul, Minnesota have. Oakland, California has.
Cambridge, Massachusetts.
Maine is voting on doing it for all their elections. They're voting on that this year.
About a half a dozen states that have permissible, that allow this type of voting.
My brother-in-law lives in St. Paul. We don't have to ask him.
Ask him how he likes it?
Yeah.
Have any of them, any municipalities you know of, tried it and gone back to?
Not yet.
Well, there is one in Washington
State. And the language here would be is to allow it, and then with the next election, you would say retain it or go back to the old way of doing things.
Well, that's the language in the charter.
No, but that's language you could put in there.
Oh.
Could you put language in such that instead of it being implemented, it puts it as a subsequent question on the ballot at a future election?
You can
You can always do that.
Such that voting on the charter would mean we get to vote on this later, as opposed, you know, we get to vote to choose to adopt this later, if, as opposed to it being an affirmative change?
It seems like you
Again, I don't want to confuse the people, either approve the charter or not approve the charter, but I think the Charter Commission in its own minutes or in its own work could say that, you know, once we approve the charter, we would like to, you know, come back and make this one of the first charter amendments after the charter has been adopted.
Would that be seen as we're trying to extend beyond a 3-year time limit?
Well, you can't go beyond the 3 years.
Right.
You get chopped off.
So someone else would have to.
Someone else would have to carry that
but
back.
You make
we're
it right.
Wrapping up against the...
So the public really does not decide if they want to change the way they vote. We just present it as a new ballot. The public is trained on how to use the new ballot. They use it to vote, and while they're voting, they say there's a question on the ballot. I'm trying to see if I'm hearing this correctly. A question on the ballot saying, retain this way of voting or go back to the old way. Am I hearing this right? The public doesn't have a choice?
The public would not have a choice. It would have to be a charter change, either with the whole charter or some sort of charter amendment. There would have to be a new system of voting. And then once that is tried for an election or maybe two elections, then again another charter amendment would follow to say we want to retain it or we want to revert back to the old system.
I hope we could have a discussion about this idea or the advisory group or at one of our
That would be interesting. Mm-hmm. How they understand it and what's their reaction.
Yeah, because it seems that, I don't know, the public may not take kindly to the fact that, okay, so what are you really telling me? Do you want us to go with this or not? You know, it's like, why didn't you go ahead and do it? You know?
We're not.
I mean, if you put it in the charter in that manner.
Oh, yeah, I brought nine. That's what I had.
See, the public is always scared of something new and different.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Of course.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I try to run it. I mean, I'm intrigued by it. I don't know how other commissioners feel if you're absolutely in opposition to that.
If you have time and the energy and inclination or so on, you see you have this outreach group, mm-hmm. whether it's 15 or 75 people, it would be kind of fun to do a sample ballot and have a sample vote and just go through the process.
Probably with the 15, because that's the advisory.
Yeah, to have everybody vote and then tabulate the votes and see how it works.
But I think we would have to present to them a ballot with names. I think that's what got me screwed up the first time around.
Oh, okay. You want? I'm sorry. I had Jones, Doe, and Smith, and mm-hmm. originally that I changed
think,
it to ABC.
Yeah.
John, and if we run this up the before the advisory group, I think it's really important that there's a statement of why they even consider it.
Mm-hmm.
Statement that says, the argument that you're making, reduce the squabbling or whatever word you want to use. Saves money. One election and no primary involved with it.
So if we want to put it, talk about it with the advisory group, I'd be more than happy to draft up like a opening explanatory piece.
Yeah, because I think that would be important. Because the first question anybody would ask is, why are you thinking of doing this? You know, the other way works so well, you know.
What's working is working, yeah.
The gas combustion engines work real well. Why do I want a battery?
And then I can see with constituency of the city being aged, I think it's going to be hard for them to change.
Yeah, that's what I'm concerned about.
Yeah.
Though I am being an old person myself, mm-hmm. and knowing that I'm not afraid of change, you know, and I know Charles certainly isn't. He's older than I am, older.
But there are some people that are really afraid of change.
I do know that.
And I'm sitting here pondering to do something like this without them fully understanding what they're doing. You know, just like absentee ballots. It took a long time for seniors to understand that if I fill out this ballot and mail it in, my vote really is going to get counted. It took a long time for seniors to understand that their ballot will get counted. So to change something this drastic, and a lot of seniors that vote by absentee may not be at a meeting to explain to them how to use this new ballot.
Yeah.
So we've got to think about those persons that vote absentee.
I agree. Mm-hmm.
So is the general thought to chat about this with the advisory group, or is that
probably in
the advisory group?
In October, if their October meeting.
Okay.
No October.
Okay, but we're going to put names on it rather than.
Letters?
Yeah.
Start with their names on it.
Yeah.
Put the city council names on here.
No. Well, I mean, they don't even have to be last names as long as they're the first name.
Sure.
Put the charter commissioner's names on
there. You go.
Okay.
I have, if we're willing to move on, I do have another one that I wanted to bring up. That's all right. Here,
is she coming back?
This way.
Unless they return. Oh, I need that. So.
There's a bunch of them there. So.
They're coming on this side.
Yeah.
Keep yours. They come on this
side. The side. If she comes back, I'll give it to her.
So this would be find the right proposal 23-207. So 3-207, this would just add a second part to it. Right now it says, except for purposes of inquiries or investigations into accordance with section 3-206, the city council and its members shall deal with city officers and employees who are subject to the direction and supervision of the mayor solely through the mayor, and neither the city council nor its members shall give orders to any such officer or employee, either publicly or privately. And this would add another piece that says, the council may require quarterly reporting to council by appointed department heads on activities within their departments, progress on departmental budgets, progress on performance goals set in departmental budgets, and to answer questions from council. And so the whole, I think it's pretty self-explanatory as to the purpose, but it's the idea is that it requires that department heads give updates on at least a quarterly basis to the council on what's going on.
In what kind of setting? The committee or before council?
I suppose that would be up to the council because it's kind of.
So we need to be specific in that.
I don't know. I haven't asked the attorney. I don't know the answer.
I would think the whole, you know, the whole council.
The general council. Because I'm quite sure the public might want to be able to sit in on those.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I know we're still working on the budget part as far as how often the administration will be reporting to council. So how does this conflict or?
This is, I guess, yeah, it does say departmental budgets, and the reason I included that, so it could be a topic of discussion, but this is not intended to, the purpose of this is not to override budget reporting or in any way substitute for budget reporting. This is focused more on what's going on in planning and development or what's going on in the utilities, you know.
In order to see variances early on in the,
no, I think budgetary year? I think budgetary stuff should be a separate report to council.
And then I'm kind of wondering.
So these activities you're speaking of that they're reporting on, is it programs that are dependent on budgetary?
Well, everything the city does is dependent upon
right.
the budget.
So is it an assessment of how well they're doing? Or?
Yes.
Okay, so they can make some adjustments.
So they understand what's going on and how that part of the city is performing.
And I think also it would be good, because you know people do referrals all the time, and they don't get a response all the time. So if a department head comes, and we put a referral into the department and they haven't responded, it's also an opportunity for them to be exposed during that quarterly question and answering on where is the update of a referral that's been sent to their department. But what concerns me is if we do a quarterly report and you got the regular general order of businesses of council day-to-day operation and dealing with the mayor and the council, how do you intermingle those together and still not be in there till 12 or 1 o'clock at night? Because if you got a council meeting and you want, do all the department heads come all at once or do they stagnate it?
Yeah, I said may require quarterly reporting and I didn't put that in dates there, so that the council could schedule it in a way so it's not all stacked up and
mm-hmm.
you know, all in one meeting or something like that.
So this is in person, not necessarily just through
right.
Copies.
Right. Because it says answer questions. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I have a problem with the word may. The council may require to me, that's a loophole.
Yeah.
They don't have to do it. Because it said they may require. I think I'm trying to think of a word to put
shall.
In there.
Yeah.
Will.
Well, I guess I left it up. The reason I was thinking about, you know, how you word that too. The reason I said may is I thought it might be at some point the council says, well, we only really need to hear from this one area like twice a year because there's not a lot going on. But I mean, I'm not. I figure if the council wants to hear more often than, you know, once or twice a year, they could do quarterly. I guess I didn't want to take total discretion out of their hands, but I can understand wanting to make sure that people are up on a quarterly basis as well.
I'd like to see what Councilman Mays thinks about this, since he's on the council.
No, I think you got to do work at the city, the sale and the mail. Sale means must make it discretion.
Mm-hmm.
Quarterly is always good to keep updates. Earlier on, when y'all talked about the regular council meeting, I think it can be done in committee meetings. You might want to say, you know, on the, you can put in there a certain date. So
emergency manager was here, he specifically set up committees so that police and fire were one, and public works, and they would come in and they would give reports. To me, that's not really needed, but I think Councilman Mays is right, is to come in once in a while to a committee meeting where there's time to talk, and just, because sometimes the fire department would say, well, we're down five people, and then the council would question whether they need money to hire people or whatever. And then, of course, when the water was going on, public works became a very big thing to be before the council. So I think it's a great idea. I don't think it needs to be any more specific than what it is.
I like the idea of using the word may to give council discretion about how they manage it. Because there's scheduling pieces and priorities of need, and that council, I think, would understand where it is they want to go, what they think they need to know. But it means then that, in my mind, that departments have to come forward and report to council on a periodic basis.
So I got a question. So if the council makes, so say Eric Mays want to request a report from someone, a department head, that he haven't got a report, and he got to have majority of his colleagues to support this, to bring a department head here, or is he allowed the powers as a council to request for a report from a department head that has not reported in the last year?
You want the legal thing, or do you want the way that seems to work around here?
Let me see the one that seems to work around here first.
What seems to, any council member just picks up the telephone and calls the department head.
And they show up.
And the legal thing.
No,
or
they don't want that.
And the legal thing is when it says council, it takes a vote or action of the council.
Yeah, it's here, you know, that there's provision that says that the council member shall work through the administration via the mayor, and they would put their inquiries to the mayor, and the mayor would then send it to the council member. That would be the normal chain of command. What we're doing here is that there's just like you do a budget report or something like that, like a budget, not exactly like, but there's unusual circumstances, or there's either a monthly, quarterly report that these department heads would submit. And if there were questions on it, unless we specifically say that the council will act directly to the department head, the charter says works through the mayor.
What if we change the wording that reads, the council shall require quarterly reporting to a special council called council meeting no later than the last day of the quarter, and then the rest of the sentence, the paragraph as written? Because I'm listening to what Mr. Councilman Mays is saying, that quarterly would be good. Maybe we can have it no later than the last day of the quarter. That still gives the council discretion to call which department heads to which meeting, to a special call meeting, to hear their reports.
Okay, but where does the administration portion of it come in? Because I think it's important, because that's one of the complaints, is that council, going directly to departments rather than going through administration.
So, like, today, legally speaking, council people can't go directly to department heads.
No, but I mean, this is the way it reads, though. The council may require quarterly report to council by appointed department heads.
Yeah.
So where does the administration come in?
So
the...
You're right, John. Today, they could not, they do not go to a department head. Technically, legally, they would not go directly to the department head. If they have an inquiry, they would take the majority of the council to pass a resolution, if the city attorney allows them to pass a resolution, to inquire of the mayor, please tell, give us a report regarding the fire at WXYZ or whatever. But we're making an exception here to say right. that we're not going to have this normal procedure. We're going to have an extraordinary procedure, which is all right.
So what I thought was potentially a, something I didn't think worked in the current charter is that if the council and the mayor were not getting along, the mayor could just tell the appointees to never go to council meetings, right? Mm-hmm. They'd just be in the dark. Mm-hmm. And so the purpose of this is say, even if the mayor's not going to let department heads answer council members' calls and never go to council meetings, they at least got to go on a quarterly basis to give updates to the council on what's going on.
Could I say that currently, if department heads, the mayor, or anybody didn't show up, you got subpoena power and the right to inquire and question. You got that now. But both the council and the mayor, the way the budget would get off teal, it always blew my mind that if you check it quarterly, things might not get so off teal by the time.
Yeah,
that's what we're trying to get to.
Okay, but now that goes back to the budget
portion. Yeah.
Because this
budget is development. Right. He's talking about programs and activities.
Right.
Yeah.
Performance.
You're right. The council has subpoena power, but I think that if council's forced to subpoena appointees, that is
hostile.
Yeah, it's the wrong.
Well, it's like, well,
your subpoena, when you're
a subpoena guilty. Is only so. Used to get you there. But if you come, then the other two is, do you need questions under oath? The problem the council ran into is just the way it is. People are less careful in information change, even budgetary information, when you just take it as it is. It's really nothing wrong in this city to have investigative hearings like you see in Washington and Lansing. The city council over a practice, and it's a bad practice, don't have hearings.
Right, but look at Darnell Early on the Hill, right? They invite their people to come. They don't subpoena them. And when they had to issue a subpoena for Darnell Early, that immediately created the atmosphere. You know, it was quite clear he was there because he had to.
And invite people too. And if they come, you didn't see them on the Hill, not put them under oath. So subpoena is only to get people who don't voluntarily come. We can agree on that. But even when they voluntarily come, there's nothing offensive about putting them under oath to get good information, whether it's wild-related, financial budget, or whatever. So I'm saying the language you create, from my view, if it dictates a quarterly review of some kind, shall versus may, then really, to me, it's a budgetary necessity. The development of the budget, which I hear y'all alluding to, is different from checking the performance and staying current. Seems like he's talking about after the fact, staying current and checking. Who can holler about that? Mm-hmm. But will people do it on their own, or do it need to be dictated by the charter? I think that's what you're saying.
Like so.
How do you put into words that the council may require the administration to have the department heads and then the rest of the sentence?
Didn't we replace Will with a lot of those iffy terms in some of the other part of the chapter?
Mm-hmm.
Did we?
Yep, we did.
We got rid of Shall or
Will.
May.
Yeah.
Or
mm-hmm.
And I almost think do we need not to, we might need to add, the council may review or, you know, or require, because you may not necessarily need them there, but you may just want to review this report.
Can I say one more thing? You know how I stay out of hot water in the charter committee meeting? I leave. Thank you.
I like the last part of the statement that says, and to answer questions from council. I like that because if all I have is a piece of paper that says Department A activities for this quarter were, we had a picnic out in the back of the dome for the community and we spent $200. I'm going to find out from that department head, why did you have a picnic for the community and spend $200? What was the purpose? Were you dispensing information to the community about what?
Yeah.
It's a report can be my name on the top of the paper.
Mm-hmm. Do we need to spell out reporting and add performance, budgeting, and something else, activities?
No, I mean, it does say.
It's there.
Yeah, it's there.
Performance.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, activities and performance.
Right.
You've got activities, progress, performance, and answer questions. Yeah. It's there.
I like that. It fits it all.
And I still think we ought to put that word shall. Because I'm looking at the fight that council and the mayor just had, and if she wants, or any mayor wants to slow things down from council, and we have this word may in here, or just not change it at all and leave it for the administration to invite, it's not going to get done.
But the may is for the council, right? Mm-hmm. May is not saying the mayor may allow their department heads, it's saying the council may require that the department heads come.
Mm-hmm.
So it's given, it's not given discretion to the mayor's office, it's given discretion to the council.
Mm-hmm. I don't want them to have that discretion. I want them to do their job.
Well,
and that's something that the community is saying, we want council to do their job. And if they're going to do their job every quarter, then they shall make sure before that quarter ends, if the quarter ends September 29th, before the 29th, as a community person, I want to hear something about a department head is from the water is coming to give a report so I can be there. I wouldn't want them to have that discretion on whether or not to have a department head come to a meeting and it affects me. I want that zoning commission there to say, I'm going to be in ward A, B, and C, and this is why.
So May,
or my trash is or is not going to get picked up. I want to know why.
So May, I looked the definition up, and it's just saying might and may are used mainly to talk about possibility.
Mm-hmm.
So the council may, so it's not necessarily mandated.
Mm-hmm. That's what I said.
This right here, using may doesn't mandate.
Right, and that's why I said put shall in there instead of may.
I answered the chair's question 15 minutes ago. So.
An administration.
And John, maybe this may help. Something, the language upon council's request, the department head shall appear to report on the last quarter's report or last quarter's activity.
That sounds good.
Something like that. So yeah. The option is at the council's request.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is upon council's request, the department heads shall appear, not just report, but shall appear to report on last quarter's departmental activities. And, use the language that John has there, but something to that effect. Does that seem to work for you, John?
So the department head
shall appear before council.
Can we add, shall appear before council before the end of the quarter? That way, if they want to call a special for department heads only, so they won't be there till midnight, they still can do that.
I'd leave it to counselors
to decide that. Okay.
Organize their schedule. And if they're glutton for punishment, I've been to council meetings till 2 o'clock in the morning.
Should I redraft and bring it forward next time?
So the council got the request with the majority of the council?
Oh, is that again that 2/3?
Because sometimes you got that 5-5, and then you may not. Something that may be important for you to request, but you can't get the 5 votes in order to get the department seated.
Generally, council acts by majority vote, so that would be the 5, unless you put in a heavy majority or extraordinary majority. So if you keep it, you know, if you say the council, that means the majority of the council would, you know, it would be their request by resolution.
And I think most of the council people know that we're trying to strengthen the charter so that all persons are not only knowing what their job is, but to do it. And so I think this would help them to know that we've looked at how they operate, and this is a weakness that we see, and we're trying to strengthen it so they can do their job to report to their constituents. So if someone asks them about a certain department, then they'll know. They'll have some answers for them.
John?
I'll redraft.
Okay. Anything else?
I think you had another one.
You have another one, John?
Well, you know, I had the one from a couple of meetings ago, but I think it's kind of folding into some of the stuff that we are talking about with Jim's Board of Ethics guy, the official misconduct piece.
Okay.
I was looking at thinking with, but I think that might make sense to kind of hold off on that.
What? To Thursday?
Yeah. Or well, whenever Jim's able to.
Not this Thursday.
Yeah, this Thursday is the advisory committee meeting, and it will be here in this room.
Oh, is that when I need to have stuff for?
No.
Okay.
October.
Okay, thank you.
October. They're October meeting.
Yeah, October. Yeah. Okay.
And I'm going to give you some information to put in your report for your advisory committee.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Is that the first Thursday of advisory committee?
Yes. Yeah. It's September 1st, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So we started that back up?
We never stopped. We just missed one meeting.
Oh, okay.
And that's at 6?
6 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. Is this room going to be big enough?
Well, we've used it before.
Mm-hmm. Is this a meeting where we put out treats?
No.
Yeah,
we do.
We can be very light.
What kind of treats?
We can be light because we will be putting out treats for the 15th.
Yeah.
So,
exactly. And who's paying for these?
We bring in treats. Yeah.
We did get training.
Yeah, we did.
$5 or whatever you like for a gift
card.
Nancy, our intern, we're going to do proclamation, and I got to talk to Heidi before I give you the information.
He doesn't change.
When do you need this?
Well, you can bring it.
You should have put in your memo. I could have brought it.
I don't
carry money.
That's okay. So,
a little I just have plastic.
No. I don't believe so.
So
I think I have
$1. And I agree with her, Commissioner Weston, when she's going to take the mail out. So is he going home?
He's not going to draft. He actually gave us language.
Yeah.
This looks very suspicious. Everybody's reaching for their wallets and
Oh, no. Oh, man, he's got the lint.
I'll put $10 for it.
Okay, anything else?
Yes, ma'am. Ms. Mitchell Ford sent me a message as we were speaking, September 27th or October 11th. What is your choice?
October 11th, we have the Committee of the Whole. September 27th, do we have anything?
You know, the quicker, the sooner, the better.
27th?
You know, I would like to...
I think the 27th would be better.
When is it? 27th. Ms. Ford, Mitchell Ford, is she chaired the Detroit Charter Revision Commission and was very instrumental in passing or drafting their ordinance, I'm sorry, the section that deals with ethics. She then became the executive director or the person who administered the ethics for the city of Detroit, was on the paid staff, or perhaps still is on the paid staff for the city of Detroit. She works for Dickinson Wright, high class firm, and she has made the presentation. I had her do a presentation to the MAMAs, the Michigan Association of Municipal Attorneys. She made the presentation to the City of Pontiac Charter Revision Commission, and they incorporated much of their information. She has probably, she'll have an hour's presentation roughly, and then as much questions and answers as you want. So I'll bring her up the 27th at 6 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
27th.
The 27th. The 27th is Committee of the Whole. Is a Tuesday, and right. It's a 6:00.
Okay. 6:00. Yeah, 6:00. Okay, so I will do that 6:00 on the 27th for her.
Yeah.
Great.
You'll enjoy her. She's very, very.
Promotion for us, Lizzie.
Very informative.
Madam Chair.
Are you closing up the meeting because Heidi just got here?
Yes, she should have been on the top.
Oh, okay.
We couldn't go upstairs.
Oh, all right. I second it, please.
Meeting adjourned.